I'd like to invite the Honorable Consul of Greece, Mr. Ioannis Stamatekos, to say a few words.
Good evening. Καλησπέρα σας. I will be brief since everybody's here tonight to listen to Alex Kalamaridis and Dimitri Barbaresos. So I won't take a long time. The Ministry of Culture of Greece, in a bid to remember and commemorate the writer and philosopher that was Nikos Kazantzakis, has declared 2017 as the year of Nikos Kazantzakis. So I'm particularly delighted to be able to attend tonight's event with the enigmatic title Why Kazantzakis here at Rice University. And let me express once again my gratitude to Alex Kalamaridis for his effort to put this event together. Thank you very much, Alex. This event is in the tradition of literary evenings relating to modern Greece that have been organized quasi-annually for many years by the Hellenic Professional Society's Alex Kalamaridis, with the participation of Katerina Kontogiorgaki and Dimitri Barbaresos. As you know, this is not the first event on Kazantzakis that has taken place in Houston, and a symposium on Kazantzakis was also organized here at Rice by the Consulate and the Hellenic Cultural Center of the Southwestern Manos Papadakis several years ago. And I hope that it won't be the last event about Kazantzakis, because as you know, there is a new film about his life by director Yannis Maragdis, and we are very keen in bringing the film probably in the spring of next year to have a screening here in Houston. So this is going to be a kickoff event for Kazantzakis here in Houston. I'm particularly delighted because this event represents a great example of collaboration between the two Greek cultural organizations of Houston, the Hellenic Professional Society of Texas and the Hellenic Cultural Center of the Southwest. Present in the audience are the president of HPST, Mr. Dimitris Georgis. Dimitri, please stand up. The Vice President of the Hellenic Cultural Center, Anastasia Papasideri Papanikolaou. By all means, seek them out and talk to them at the reception to learn more about the two organizations and to consider becoming members. Let me also recognize and thank Dr. Lydia Kavraki for her effort in hosting this event at Rice University, and Ilias Neofitidis, who as always is covering by video and by many photos tonight's event. Nikos Kazantzakis is widely considered a giant of modern Greek literature. He was nominated for the Nobel Prize in Literature in 9 different years. Kazantzakis' novels include Zorba the Greek, Christ the Crucified, Captain Michalis, and The Last Temptation of Christ. He also wrote plays, travel books, memoirs, and philosophical essays, such as The Saviors of God, Spiritual Exercises. His fame spread in the English-speaking world due to the cinematic adaptations of Zorba the Greek and The Last Temptation of Christ. More than a writer, Kazantzakis was a philosopher. He reflected upon a series of monumental transformations which took place during his time. The decline of empires and the rise of nation-states, the development of a modern economy and the destruction of traditional ways of life, the contestation of traditional religion and the birth of philosophical currents such as existentialism. Kazantzakis tried to understand the new world that was emerging, combining insights from Western philosophy with a genuine study of Cretan popular culture. His works also explore what Kazantzakis believed to be the unique physical and spiritual location of Greece, a nation that belongs to neither the East nor the West. He viewed Greece's special mission as the reconciliation of Eastern instinct with Western reason. echoing a familiar theme in his novels, that of balancing logic against emotion. And as we can still see today, this balancing act has been proven an incredibly difficult exercise for both the Greek politicians and the Greek people. Thank you very much, and let's enjoy the evening.
So, Kazantzakis. Presenting Kazantzakis to any audience represents a challenge not encountered with other writers from Greece. Even casual acquaintance with the author's works, for example, through Martin Scorsese's 1988 cinematic adaptation of his novel from 1955, The Last Temptation of Christ, generates strong emotions and points of view that diverge a lot from one person to the next. Meeting with a well-read Asian doctor at the social occasion here in Houston a few weeks ago, he brought up to me the subject of The Last Temptation of Christ ahead of any other subject of discussion, observing wryly that although he, as a thinking person, appreciated enormously the humanness of the alternative Christ presented in the book, nevertheless, the work was offensive to Muslims and Christians alike, and the film still remained banned in Pakistan and the Vatican. So, should I answer him as a Greek, a Christian, a rational thinker, or an itinerant philosopher? Each of the four different hats would have generated a different reply. My subsequent search in Wikipedia revealed that the film was still banned in Singapore and the Philippines as of a few years ago. I also remember that for many years it was banned from Blockbuster in this country. Which then, of course, brought back memories from my childhood during Greece's military dictatorship from 1967 to 74, when Kazantzakis was derided as a communist and an atheist, and his books were banned from public view. At home, we had hidden his books behind others on the bookcase shelf. When I began reading Kazantzakis' works as a 13-year-old, at the porch of our family home on Crete in 1976, 2 years after the fall of the junta, my grandmother Erofili, a retired school teacher and a hero of the Cretan resistance against the Germans a few decades earlier, gently cautioned me that reading Kazantzakis in public could be viewed negatively, even in Crete, his native island and the place where he has always been revered. This, of course, motivated me to indulge in his works with even more adolescent fervor, and wearing the rational thinker hat, to conclude that Kazantzakis was neither a bona fide communist, like, say, the poet Kostas Varnalis, whom we presented a few years ago, nor an unabashed atheist like Richard Dawkins, who regularly rekindles controversy in these shores. So, who exactly was Nikos Kazantzakis? The giant of modern Greek literature had an equally gigantic life course worthy of the archetypal Greek hero Ulysses. To understand him, we will need to embark on his life's odyssey. In our journey through his tumultuous life, our guide will be the ample documentation provided by the Kazantzakis Museum, which opened at his father's village on Crete, Nirtia, a 15-minute drive from Heraklion, in June of 1983, on the author's centenary. Kazantzakis was born February 18, 1883, at the town of Heraklion, then called Megalo Castro, large port, the capital and most important commercial hub of Ottoman-controlled Crete. Nikos was the eldest of three surviving children, including two younger sisters. As is often the case with an eldest son, Kazantzakis grew up with a sense of chreos, the morally powerful Greek word imperfectly rendered in English as debt, or sometimes duty. Debt towards his ancestors and family traditions, debt to his not yet liberated homeland, debt to his Cretan heritage. A series of contrasts marked his childhood, the first of which was embodied in his parents. His father, Michalis Kazantzakis, Inspiration for one of the author's seven major novels, Kapitan Michalis, later in life, 1950, was an important merchant and landowner from the aforementioned village of Mirtia. At the time, the village was known as Barbari, Barbarians, a very significant name because it had been settled in the 10th century by Arabs who remained on Crete and became Christian when the Byzantine Emperor Nikephoros Kokas succeeded in retaking the island from them in 961 after two centuries of Islamic Arab occupation and rule. Michalis Kazantzakis was apparently a tough and stubborn man, whom Nikos describes as savage, a heavy man, a real beast. When our author was still a child, after yet another failed rebellion of the Greeks against the Turks on the island in 1889, his father took him to see the Cretan warriors that the Turks had hanged from a sycamore tree at the center of Heraklion and asked him to kneel and worship them, thus teaching him the duty of liberty. By contrast, his mother, Maria Christodoulaki, a village girl from nearby Rethymnon on Crete, was a simple, quiet, and sweet woman. In the eyes of her son, she appears to be a mermaid who will one day find her misplaced magic gown and go away. Seated next to her as a child, Kazantzakis would dream of being simultaneously a hero and a saint. The crushing of the 1889 anti-Ottoman Greek rebellion on Crete resulted in the Kazantzakis family decamping to Piraeus for 6 months until a fragile peace returned to the island. A few years later, in 1897, the next war on Crete, the one which eventually led to the creation of an independent Cretan state, led to 15-year-old Kazantzakis being sent off for two very formative years to the Aegean island of Naxos as a high school student at the French Commercial School of the Holy Cross, a Catholic school run by Franciscan monks. This led to the second great contrast in Kazantzakis' life. On the one side lay Crete, the Orient, tradition, chreos, remember debt or duty. On the other lay Europe, the West, a new world, desire. Because Kazantzakis was an exceptionally good student and quickly learned French and Italian at that Catholic school, a cardinal there convinced him to convert to Catholicism so as to study at the Vatican. However, when Captain Michalis found out that his spiritually inclined son was about to become a Catholic, la frangepsi, as we say in Greek, showed up one night at the school on Naxos, picked up his son, and threatened the monks that he would burn down their establishment. So, our author finished his high school studies back at Heraklion. The island of Crete now, around the turn of the century, had become a resurgent, independent, multi-ethnic state under Greek and Western control. Heraklion was growing, trying to accommodate Christian Cretans, Jews, Muslim Cretans, citizens from the rest of Greece, merchants, ship owners, self-styled politicians, and old warriors from the mountains of Crete. This was certainly a heady mix that presented the late teenage Kazantzakis with what became a recurring theme in his life. Encounter of new contrasts, resultant philosophical doubts, and, to cap it off, amorous affairs. The first of which was at Heraklion at the age of 19 with his Irish teacher of English language and literature, Kathleen Ford. Kazantzakis' brief affair with his English teacher ended when he left for Athens in the fall of 1902 to study law at the University of Athens. Still an exceptional student, he graduated with highest honors in late 1905. In parallel with his studies, though, he immersed himself into the cultural scene of Athens, and in 1905, his translations of French and Italian authors began appearing in Athenian magazines. While his first novel, Ophis και Krino, Serpent and Lily, inspired by his affair with Kathleen Ford, was published under the nickname Karma Nirvami, a nickname that echoes his emerging interest in Eastern religions. Serpent and Lily. It was not a traditional novel at all. It was a remarkable, albeit youthful, philosophical pursuit in the form of a story of a young painter, worshipper of lust and beauty, who enjoys what life offers him and who gradually becomes dominated by the idea of death. Deciding that death and life are connected with beauty and erotic love, he brings his girlfriend into a closed room immensely filled with fresh flowers for a night of lovemaking. Finally, in the morning, they are discovered asphyxiated. None other than the patriarch of Greek letters at the time, the poet Kostis Palamas, writing also with an alias at the magazine Panathenaea in early 1906, weighed in with the following incisive and prophetic remarks about Serpent and Lily and its 23-year-old creator.
Είναι μαζί ιστορία και ποίημα. Η ιστορία εκτελείται σε ένας μονότροπος, μονόλογος, μέσα εις τα σελίδα του ημερολογίου του καλλιτέχνου. Το ποίημα είναι χυμένων φανταχού. Είναι ανανικών και νοσηρών και ωραίων και φανάσιμων. Συμπλέγουν αστόχαστα, ομού και βαθύγνωμα, τας εκστάσεις του μυστικισμού με του πριαπισμού τη λύσα. Εικόνη ενός σατήρου και μιας ψυχής, η σύμπλεγμα διάρρηκτον, εφιάλτης και παραλήρημα, πάθος και κελάδιμα. Έργων ενθυμίζουν όλη την ηθικήν αντινομία του αθλίου ανθρώπου, φυλακή, μέσα εις την οποία αλληλοσπαράσσονται αδιάκοπα η σάρξ και το πνεύμα. Αλλά εντάφτω, ελπίζω ότι ο όφης αυτός το δολερός και το κρίνον αυτό δεν είναι παρά επρώτε εκδηλώσεις της ευαισθησίας νεαρού λογοτέχνου, ώστις με τον καιρό θα δημιουργήσει έργα ωραία και υγιή, ομού συγκινούντα και ευεργετούντα, ανυψώνοντα και καθαρίζοντα την ψυχή, ως είναι τα γεννήματα της αρτίας και ιδεώδους τέχνης.
So, even though Serpent and Lily is not as well known as Kazantzakis' novels from the 40s and 50s, in recent years this work has developed a cult following, that's why we're talking about it. And it has been translated into 10 languages that show the global spread of interest in Kazantzakis. English and French, Hebrew and Arabic, Spanish and Portuguese, Albanian, Bulgarian, and Romanian, as well as the South Indian language Malayalam. During this same time, our author fell in love with Galatia Alexiou, the daughter of a prominent publisher from Heraklion and an important writer in her own right, who eventually became his first wife in 1911. However, their affair did not prevent him from moving on his own to Paris in 1907 so as to pursue his doctoral dissertation at the Collège de France, which he completed in 1909. Paris was formative for Kazantzakis' philosophy. Εδώ η ζωή είναι αλλιώτικη. Life is different here, he wrote back to his mother and sisters. The legacy of his Paris stay was his intense exposure and study of two major philosophical figures of the time, the French Henri Bergson and the German Friedrich Nietzsche. A polymath of Polish-Jewish descent, Bergson was particularly influential due to his arguments that processes of immediate experience and intuition are more significant than abstract rationalism and science for understanding reality. Those were expounded through Bergson's three major works, Time and Free Will, Matter and Memory, and Creative Evolution. Bergson informed Kazantzakis' worldview as our author developed his personal perspectives of cultures and peoples in his subsequent many travels. The other figure, Nietzsche, became the subject of Kazantzakis' doctoral thesis, which was on Nietzsche's philosophy regarding law and the state. With that thesis as a starting point, Nietzsche eventually turned into one of the springboards of Kazantzakis' own philosophy 15 years later. With his studies completed and full of energy and enthusiasm, Our author traveled through Italy and returned to Greece, where he settled in Athens with Galatia in 1910 and married her, as we saw, shortly thereafter. He channeled his energy through multiple activities. One of those activities was the writing of a tragedy, Thysia, Sacrifice, based on the old folk tale of the sacrifice of Smaragda, the secret lover of the master builder who was constructing the bridge at the town of Arta, so that his life could be spared and the bridge could be completed. The play got the first prize at the drama contest, and a few years later, renamed Protomastoras, Master Builder, it was set to music as an opera by none other than the Smyrniot Manolis Kalomiris, the most important classical music composer of modern Greece. It can be characterized as the cornerstone of the many theatrical plays Kazantzakis wrote over the years. Here is a short sample from that opera, from a 1944 recording in Athens with 21-year-old Maria Callas in the role of Smaragda, the master builder's tragic lover. Besides writing this tragedy, the young Kazantzakis embarked on a dizzying array of other activities in the turbulent Greece of the 1910s. A true bohemian, he became a central figure of the literary and political circles of the time, including the Parea της Δεξαμενής, which met at an old Cretan tavern near Mount Lycabettus in Athens, and the spiritual commune with, among others, the poets Kostas Varnalis and Marcos Avieris, at his in-law's village of Krasi on Crete in the summer of 1912. As the Balkan Wars broke out in the fall of 1912, he volunteered with the Greek army since his homeland, Crete, had not yet formally become part of the state of Greece. In this way, he witnessed firsthand the liberation of Epirus from Ottoman rule. A couple of years later, he met in Athens the promising poet and socialite Angelos Sikelianos. Recognizing in each other a brotherly soul, the two men embarked together on a 40-day spiritual sojourn on Mount Athos, aiming to design a new religion and studying Tolstoy, Dante, and the Buddha. Kazantzakis doubled down with a lengthy sojourn at the monastery of Virgin of the Mountain, Panagia του Βουνού, on the Cycladic island of Sifnos in the summer of 1915. In an effort to make ends meet, our author started in early 1917 a business venture aimed at exploiting a lignite, in other words, low-quality carbon, ore, near the beach of Prastova in Mani on the southern coast of the Peloponnese. His partner in this business venture was Georgis Zorbas, a lively and striking guy he had met at Mount Athos. After a few wintry months of efforts at the beach, their venture ended up in failure. But, of course, that storied experience became the seed that blossomed 3 decades later in the form of Kazantzakis' most famous novel, Vios και Politia του Αλέξη Ζορμπά, The Life and Times of Alexis Zorbas. The dizzying lifestyle of our author did not quite fit with the settled family life with Galatia. On the contrary, the end of the failed venture marked the true beginning of Kazantzakis' lifelong travel quests. A childhood friend, Yannis Stavridakis, now the consul of Greece in Zurich, invited him there in 1918. In Switzerland, Kazantzakis fell in love with the brilliant writer Eli Lambridi, his Mundita, describing in his diary their ορμητική επικοινωνία, impetuous communication, and his εμπείρετη μετάγγιση της ψυχής του σε εκείνη, feverish transfusion of his soul into hers. However, being accomplished and well-connected, the 36-year-old Kazantzakis was summoned back to Greece in 1919 by the government of Venizelos as a newly appointed public servant tasked with the repatriation into Greece of the hundreds of thousands of ethnic Greeks who lived in the Caucasus and were in danger from Kemal and the Turkish armies. He assembled a team of friends, including Zorbas and Consul Stavridakis, and moved to Tbilisi in Georgia's Caucasus mountains for 15 months, successfully repatriating 150,000 people to Greek-controlled Macedonia and later Thrace, despite a self-recorded temptation to leave his duties and Greece in the form of another intense love affair with the beautiful young Georgian Barbara Nikolaevna. The turn of the decade, 1920, drove Kazantzakis to travel more. His friend, Stavridakis, had just died from pneumonia in Tbilisi. Another close friend, the energetic patrician, politician, and writer Ion Dragoumis, was assassinated in Athens, victim of the tumultuous, polarized times. And Venizelos suffered an electoral defeat in the polls, an outcome that annulled Kazantzakis' government appointment. So the next few years, until 1924, saw him in extensive sojourns around Europe, especially in Vienna and Berlin, places where the recent loss of the Great War and the onerous debts imposed by the winning Entente, Britain, France, Italy, and the United States, had generated poverty, misery, and resentment, albeit accompanied by the famously creative cultural undercurrent that characterized the German Weimar Republic. During this time, Kazantzakis, having imbibed, besides Nietzsche and Bergson, the worldviews and struggles of the Buddha and Lenin, crystallized his own philosophy of life. Compelled by a strange turn of events, he then wrote up his philosophy in a small book with the double title Ασκητική, Spiritual Exercises, and Salvatores Dei, Saviors of God. Ασκητική was written in Berlin in late 1922 and early 1923. While living in impoverished Vienna in 1922, our author developed a weird facial skin condition including terrible swelling and pus, which would flare up and stay for hours or days. A chance encounter with, well, since he was in Vienna, who else? A famous Viennese psychoanalyst by the name of Dr. Wilhelm Steckel led to the diagnosis that Kazantzakis suffered from a rare psychosomatic condition that nevertheless had been quite common among ascetic figures, monks, hermits, and saints in the early Middle Ages. These people vowed to chastity, but tortured by the temptations of the flesh, would sometimes rush to the nearest town in search of sexual gratification. However, the terrible internal guilt they faced expressed itself in this skin condition, which rendered it impossible for them to break their vows. This story is actually instructive of the internal conflict Kazantzakis faced throughout his life between the love of life embodied in the persona of Zorbas and the ascetic withdrawal embodied in the Buddha. This episode did make it into one of his seven famous novels, Christ Re-Crucified, or Christos Ξανασταυρώνεται, many years later, in 1948. In that work, the young shepherd, Manolios, has been selected to play the role of Christ in a theatrical drama on the life of Jesus that is enacted at his village. However, when he's tempted to visit the widow Katerina, the prostitute of the village who has been given the role of Mary Magdalene, his cheeks, his lips, his chin swell uncontrollably and let out on his face a thick, sticky fluid.
Όλο το πρόσωπο είχε εξαφρίσει. Τα μάτια του είχαν γίνει δύο μικρές χάντρες. Η μύτη του είχε χωθεί μέσα στα τουμπανιασμένα μάγουλα και το στόμα του είχε γίνει μια τρύπα. Δεν ήταν τούτο ανθρώπου πρόσωπο. Ήταν μια σάρκινη μουτσούδα, απάνθρωπη, ανατριχιαστικιά.
Continuing in the novel, just like the ancient god Pan, Nikolios, a boy best described as a wild mountain goat, recounts to Manolios how his own grandfather had once tried to become a monk, but eventually gave up because every time he tried to go to the village to be with a woman, he ended up with the same leprosy-like skin condition. He figured out that this disease was sent by God as a means for him to overcome temptation. As soon as Kazantzakis left Vienna for Berlin, at the advice of Dr. Steckel, his condition disappeared. His life of discovery and experiences resumed, and his theological ideas and the theological ideas already bubbling within found their expression in Salvatore's day. In a letter to Galatia, with whom he was still married and with whom he remained lifelong friends even after their inevitable divorce in 1926, he writes,
«Γράφω τώρα την Ασκητική, ένα βιβλίο μυστήκ, όπου διαγράφω τη μέθοδο να ανέβει η ψυχή από κύκλο σε κύκλο, ωστότου φτάσει στην ανώτατη επαφή. Είναι πέντε κύκλοι. Εγώ, ανθρωπότητα, γης, σύμπαντο, Θεός. Πώς να ανεβούμε όλα τούτα τα σκαλοπάτια και όταν φτάσουμε στο ανώτατο, να ζήσουμε όλους τους προηγούμενους κύκλους. Το γράφω επίτηδες, χωρίς ποίηση, με στεγνή επιτακτική φόρμα. Βλέπεις, σου μιλάω πολύ γι' αυτό πάλι, γιατί είναι ο τελευταίος καρπός της αναζήτησής μου. Ως πότε η αναζήτηση? Ή μήπως σκοπός μου είναι μονάχα η αναζήτηση, δηλαδή πορεία από σημείο σε σημείο? Μήπως τέτοια είναι και η πορεία του Θεού? Η αναζήτηση προστάνω και με συνοχή. Ίσως αυτός να είναι ο σκοπός του σύμπαντος. Σκοπός και μέσα ταυτίζονται. Ο Θεός είναι η ανώτατη έκφραση του ακούραστου και του αγωνιζόμενου, ο ακατάλητα, αγιάτρευτα αναζητών.
Here are some key excerpts from Ασκητική, narrated in part by another Cretan intellectual, the late actor Manos Katrakis, 1908-1984.
Είμαστε από μια σκοτεινή άβυσσο. Καταλήγουμε σε μια σκοτεινή άβυσσο. Το μεταξύ φωτεινό διάστημα το λέμε ζωή. Οι Κινέζοι έχουν μια καταπληκτική κατάρα. Την κατάρα μου να έχεις να γεννηθείς σε ενδιαφέρουσα εποχή. Η κατάρα αυτή μας έπιασε. Χρέος μας να μετατρέψουμε όσο μπορούμε με τον αγώνα μας, με τη δύναμη του μυαλού, με την περηφάνεια της ψυχής, την κατάρα τούτη σε ευλογία.
Μια προσταγή μέσα μου. Σκάψε. Τι βλέπεις. Ανθρώπους και πουλιά. Νερά και πέτρες. Σκάψε ακόμα. Τι βλέπεις. Ιδέες και ονείρατα. Αστραπές και φαντάσματα. Σκάψε ακόμα. Τι βλέπεις. Δεν βλέπω τίποτα. Νύχτα βούβη. Πηχτής αθάνατος. Ανθάνατος. Σκάψε ακόμα. Ωχ. Φωνές γρυκό και κλάματα. Φτερά γρυκό στον άλλο όχτο. Μην κλαις. Μην κλαις. Δεν είναι στον άλλο όχτο. Οι φωνές, τα κλάματα και τα φτερά είναι η καρδιά σου. Ο Θεός μου δεν είναι παντοδύναμος. Αγωνίζεται. Κινδυνεύει κάθε στιγμή. Τρέχει. Φωνάζει. Ο Θεός μου δεν είναι πανάγνωστος. Είναι γεμάτος σκληρότητα. Άγρια δικαιοσύνη. Και ξεδιαλέγει ανήλαια το καλύτερο. Δεν σπλαχνίζεται. Δεν νοιάζεται για ανθρώπους και ζώα. Μήτε για αρετές και ιδέες. Όλα τούτα τα αγαπάει μια στιγμή, τα συντρίβει αιώνια και διαδέχει. Ο Θεός μου δεν είναι πάντοτε. Ο Θεός μου κινδυνεύει. Μες στην περιοχή της εφήμερης σάρκας μας δεν μπορεί να σωθεί αν δεν τον σώσουμε εμείς. Δεν μπορούμε να σωθούμε αν δεν σωθεί αυτός. Είμαστε ένα. Από το τυφλό σκουλίκι στο βυθό του ωκεανού ως την απέραντη παλέστρα του γαλαξία ένας μονάχα αγωνίζεται και κινδυνεύει. Ο εαυτός μας. Και στο μικρό, το χωματέλιο στήθος μας, ένας μονάχα αγωνίζεται και κινδυνεύει. Το σύμπαν.
Πιστεύω σε ένα Θεό ακρίτα, λίγενη, στρατευόμενη, πάσχοντα, μεγαλοδύναμο, όχι παντοδύναμο, πολεμιστή στα ακρότατα σύνορα, στρατηγό, αυτοκράτορα σε όλες τις φωτεινές δυνάμεις, τις ορατές και τις αόρατες. Πιστεύω στην καρδιά του ανθρώπου, το χωματένιο αλόγιο που μέρα και νύχτα παλεύει ο ακρίτας με το θάνατο. Βοήθεια κράζεις, Κύριε. Βοήθεια κράζεις, Κύριε, και ακούω. Μακάρι όσοι ακούν και χύνονται να σε λυτρώσουν, Κύριε, και λένε. Εγώ και εσύ μονάχα υπάρχουμε. Μακάρι όσοι σε λυτρώσαν, σμίγουν μαζί σου, Κύριε, και λένε. Εγώ και εσύ είμαστε ένα. Και τις μακάρι όσοι κρατούν και δεν λυγούν πάνω στους ώμους τους το μέγα, εξαίσιο, από τρόπο μυστικό. Και το ένα τούτο δεν υπάρχει.
Nietzsche's influence is an important undercurrent in all this work. Nietzsche explored the notion of the death of God, and with him, of absolute moral social values such as Christian values. To avoid the nihilism unleashed by the death of God, Nietzsche saw the death of God as giving way to a superhuman, an übermensch. It becomes the meaning of this world, this earth, eternally, and replaces the Christian promise of redemption in another world. Kazantzakis did not quite follow Nietzsche's path all the way to the superhuman, but focused on the nihilism that the death of God entails philosophically by asking the question, what elements of the soul might give this nihilism, this futility of existence, a human meaning? Within that context, let's recall that Asketiki also contains the most famous quote associated with Kazantzakis. Δεν ελπίζω τίποτα, δεν φοβούμαι τίποτα, είμαι ελεύθερος. I hope for nothing, I fear nothing, I am free. Kazantzakis himself liked this quote so much that he wanted it etched on his tomb, a wish that was granted, with a quote indeed carved for all to see at the writer's tomb atop the Venetian rampart of the city of Heraklion. Interestingly, although Kazantzakis made this quote famous, the quote originated 18 centuries earlier in the mind of a second century current era cynic philosopher who taught in the Socratic tradition in Athens, the ascetic Demonax from Cyprus. A beloved figure by his contemporary Athenians as a wise peacemaker, Demonax taught that the only goods in life are autarky, getting rid of fear and hope, and achieving calm of the soul. The complete context of the quote within Kazantzakis' work is as follows.
Τίποτα δεν υπάρχει, μήτε ζωή, μήτε θάνατος. Κοιτάζω την ύλη και το νου, σαν δύο ανύπαρκτα ερωτικά φαντάσματα, να κυνηγούνται, να σμίγουν, να γεννούν και να αφανίζονται. Και λέω, αυτό θέλω. Ξέρω τώρα. Δεν ελπίζω τίποτα. Δεν φοβούμαι τίποτα. Λυτρώθηκα από το νου και από την καρδιά. Ανέβηκα πιο πάνω. Είμαι ελεύθερος. Αυτό θέλω. Δεν θέλω τίποτε άλλο. Ζητούσα ελευθερία.
Throughout his life, Kazantzakis considered Salvatore's Day to be the definitive distillation of his philosophy. All my other works are but commentary on Asketiki, he used to say. He kept tinkering with it and making edits to it until he died. Even though this work was eclipsed by the success of the seven major books he wrote towards the end of his life, in the 40s and 50s, the value of Asketiki is being rediscovered, and today, in Greece, it is by far the best-selling among the 40,000 plus books by Kazantzakis sold there annually. After the end of his German sojourn in 1924 and a four-month stay in Italy, where he discovered St. Francis of Assisi, who became the subject of one of his seven major novels almost 30 years later in 1953, Kazantzakis returned to Greece. At this point, he decided that he was ready to undertake what he then perceived as his life's ambition. Prove himself as an epic poet by creating a modern sequel Ulysses' Odyssey, based on his own philosophical ideas. The ambition was very much in line with the zeitgeist, the spirit of the times that also saw the creation of T.S. Eliot's Wasteland in 1922, Hart Crane's The Bridge in 1930, Ezra Pound's The Cantos, started in 1917, and James Joyce's, of course, Ulysses in 1922 and Finnegan's Wake in 1939. The creation of his Odyssey became the main driver of Kazantzakis' life and work between 1924 and its completion in 1938. A voluminous work, almost 3 times the size of Homer's original. Its 33,333 17-syllable verses, arranged into 24 rhapsodies, just like in the original Odyssey, recount Ulysses' adventures and travels after he returned to Ithaca and left again, through Sparta, Crete, Egypt, the rest of Africa, and Antarctica, until his eventual death in the frozen Southern Ocean. The work is a veritable linguistic treasure trove. It is estimated that it contains 7,500 words not found in any Greek dictionary. Consider some of the epithets used for Ulysses himself. Doxaras, Vathinousis, Athletis, Ασκητής, Θεοφωνιάς, Ολισθέναχτος, Φωτοδόξαρος, Γοργοπίχερος, Καραβάς, Μονιάς, Κορφιονούσης, Φλογάς, Αλεπονούς, Ανδροφωνιάς, Ψυχαρπάχτης. To write and edit his Odyssey, the ascetic Kazantzakis sustained himself through commissioned writings, translations, plays for children, and so on. His amazing work ethic made him omnipresent. He also traveled a lot, usually paid for by Athenian newspapers such as Eleftheros Logos, free speech, so that Kazantzakis would interview leading political and other figures of the time. In this way, our author traveled extensively in the Soviet Union, where he was welcomed as a writer sympathetic to the communist transformation of the former Russian Empire. He also traveled to Spain, Italy, England, Egypt, where he met Kavafi, whom he quickly recognized as the most important intellectual in that land, the Sinai, the Holy Land, the Peloponnese, China, and Japan. For Kazantzakis, traveling was not just a visit to other lands. It was a way to collect the riches of the world so that they could be distilled inside him and then, passing through his own experiences and emotions, be transformed into an artistic creation. He embraced all aspects of life during his trips. By learning the languages of the places he traveled to and interacting with the most important personalities all the way to the lowest individuals. Many of his travels were motivated by the need to collect images and forms for the Odyssey. However, in the end of the day, some of his most memorable works are indeed his travel impression books collected under the title Taxidevondas, while traveling. The 14 years, underscored by writing the Gargantuan Odyssey, saw three new persons coming to the life of Kazantzakis. One was a young fellow Cretan, a novelist from Rethymno named Pantelis Prevelakis, an accomplished writer in his own right, who became a close friend, almost an adoptee of sorts of Kazantzakis, and he eventually wrote a biography of our author. The second one was the Greco-Romanian communist writer Panayiotis Strati. Kazantzakis met Strati in the Soviet Union and they became instant friends, deciding to work together on the political and literary arenas, although their plans eventually bore limited fruit, in part because of Strati's untimely death from tuberculosis in 1935. The third person was his eventual life's love, the woman who became his companion for the last 32 years of his life, starting in 1924, Eleni Samiou. A writer and journalist in her own right, Eleni devoted all those years as companion and secretary to Nikos. The divorce with his first wife was formalized in 1926, and Galatia went on to marry another literary figure, their friend, the communist poet Marcos Savieris. After many years together with Eleni, and having settled at an architecturally striking, austere house they built on the island of Aegina, Kazantzakis eventually married her in 1945 with his friend, Angelos Sikelianos, as the best man. Eleni, of course, outlived him by almost half a century. She took good care of publishing his books, got involved in the struggles of Cyprus, maintained an intense lifelong nostalgia for her years with Nikos, and eventually passed away, a centenarian by design on the very day of Nikos's 120th birthday. After 7 extensive rewrites, Kazantzakis's epic sequel to the Odyssey appeared in print in 1938. The ascetic Ulysses, at times introspective and at times immersed in the quest for social justice, is very different from Homer's original hero. And he embodies Kazantzakis' philosophy and the quest for God that had been codified in Asketiki. In a relatively minor, Russia-inspired novel he also wrote during those years, originally in French, entitled Todaraba, Kazantzakis, in his fictional discussion with the black man Todaraba in front of Lenin's mausoleum in Moscow, is quite revealing.
Ό,τι με ενδιαφέρει δεν είναι ο άνθρωπος, μη δε η γης, μη δε ουρανός, αλλά η φλόγα που κατατρώει άνθρωπο, γης και ουρανό. Κάθε άλλο πράγμα που φαντάζει εφήμερο, ηλίθια φιλανθρωπικό και χορτοφάγο, ανάξιο για μια ψυχή που λευτερώθηκε από κάθε ελπίδα. Ο δικός μου αρχηγός δεν είναι κανένας από τους τρεις αρχηγούς της ανθρώπινης ψυχής. Μη δε ο Φάουστ, μη δε ο Άμπλετ, μη δε ο Δον Κιχώτης. Μα ο Δον Οδυσσέας.
Undoubtedly, the Odyssey was a major achievement. Translated into English by Kimon Fryer in the 50s, with the subtitle A Modern Sequel, it met with improbable success in the US, especially as one of the essential readings of the Beat generation. Nevertheless, by and large, it did not fare very well in its native Greece, even though it is always recognized as a landmark work of modern Greek literature. The reason for this relative lack of success was the sheer size of the work, combined with the overwhelming lexical richness, which makes it difficult to read in Greek without a lot of effort. Moreover, Kazantzakis' choice to use 17-syllable verses so as to be close to the original Homeric dactylic hexameter verses did not adapt well in modern Greek. Unlike Homeric Greek, the modern language is neither tonal nor does it distinguish between short and long vowels. That's why modern Greek folk poems are written in 15-syllable rather than 17-syllable verses. Consequently, Kazantzakis' writing appears contrived and artificially lengthened. Here's an example. 26 verses out of the 33,333, we will not do everything tonight, of the Odyssey, read by famed Greek actor Vasilis Diamandopoulos in 1992.
Στο πολυπλάνη του ταξίδι μου, στο γαμπλωτό μου αγώνα, μελίσαμε, πολέμησαν και γης και θάλασσα και γέρας. Σοριάζω στην πλωτή το πείσμα μου, τις αρετές, τις έγνες, τα κούσα, τα στερνά, τα φτωχικά του θεωμάτου ανθρώπου και απλώνω το πονί. Όλο με μια βαριά ξεσπάει κουρτούνα κι όσο να σκώσω μάτι γιώμωσε το πέλαγος στην τρίμια κι όσο λιμούς ανάμεσα ουρανού και θάλασσας μονάχος με του τυροψη καρδιά συντρόφισα και σκύλα το νου μου με κοντάρι παρφυρό γλυκό τον αγού χιάζει στις κεφαλής μολογυρού τις γκρεμισμένες πολεμίστρες. Συντρόφοι μου παλί κι εσείς καινούρια φύτρα του νησιού μου στη γης δεχίνω πίνω το κρασί στη γιά του νου του ανθρώπου. Το αγεράκι στεριά να φυσάει, τρεμό παίξει μέστρα και να πηδάει σαν μέγας δέλφινας το μητερό καράβι με τα μεγάλα μάτια τα νυχτά στην αφισμένη πλώρα και την ανάγερτη του γάβρα ουρά τη γαλαζοβαμένη. Βουβός μακριά το διάκι απ' τη στεριά καθώντας Οδυσσέας, αγάλια γάλια τη λιγάδιαζε στα φρένα το νησί του, ξερίζωνε τα σπίτια, τα βουνά, τα δέντρα, το λιμάνι. Κι όλα με ορμή κυρούσαν και έπεφταν στο χώνος του μυαλού του. Ξεπάτωσε έρισα όλο το νησί και το κατάπιε η μνήμη. Σαν άδειασε ο γυαλός και χάθηκε στα μάτια του η πατρίδα, πικρά πολύ τον κατασκεύασε τα σπλάχνα του και ο τέψαν. Παιδιά, ποτέ μας πια στα μάτια μας δεν θα την ξαναδούμε. μικρό-μικρό πουλί ήταν διάβηκε παιχνίδι και συντρίφτη και μια ρογιά σγουρός βασίλικος και έπεσε από τα αυτή μας.
It was very aptly said by the critic Yannis Motsios that Kazantzakis is a great poet in his novels, but very prose-like and pedestrian in his verses. After publishing The Odyssey in 1938, Kazantzakis traveled to England in the footsteps of Shakespeare, but with the war looming, eventually retreated with Eleni at their home on the island of Aegina, where they endured the hardships of the war and of German occupation of Greece. During those years, Kazantzakis, ascetic and hardworking as ever, continued to make a living by writing historical plays, Julian, Constantine Paleologos, etc. Began planning a second epic poem based on Akritas, the heroic eastern frontier epics of Byzantine times, and began a fruitful collaboration to create the landmark translation of Homer's original epics into modern Greek, together with noted philologist Ioannis Kakridis, 1901-92. Most significantly, however, during those dark years, Kazantzakis returned to writing novels in earnest. This was the move that would soon give him international recognition. He did this acting upon the suggestion of Eleni, and he treated novel writing almost as a form of light entertainment. However, he soon realized that novels represented a perfect way to express aspects of his own life and experiences that could not be easily placed within the strict forms of poetry and theatrical plays. The first work of this period, written within a few months in 1941 and 42 in Aegina, was Το Συναξάρι του Ζορμπά, Zorba's religious biography, which eventually saw the light of day as Βίος και Πολιτεία του Αλέξη Ζορμπά in 1943. After the war, the book was translated into many languages, and won the prize of Best Foreign Work in France in 1954. This fictionalized recollection of Kazantzakis' ventures with Georgis Zorbas many years earlier became, of course, our author's blockbuster success, eventually after its well-known Oscar-winning 1964 cinematic rendition. Zorba the Greek, by Cypriot director Michalis Kakogiannis, with Mexican-American star Anthony Quinn in the eponymous role, became, fairly or not, emblematic of Greeks heard everywhere, including its music, the iconic Sirtaki dance composed by the patriarch of Greek music composers, Mikis Theodorakis, now in his 90s. Even though Kazantzakis started some of his other novels during his World War II years at Aegina, as the war was coming to a close with uncertain consequences for the political unity of a post-war Greece, he felt the need to once again make the leap from the world of words to the world of political action. To that end, in early 1945, he became leader of a small party, the Socialist Labor Union, in a futile effort to promote unity in a country increasingly torn apart by civil strife between the right and left factions. In this capacity, he chaired a committee that visited Crete in the summer of that year, so as to record the German atrocities and destruction that had taken place there during the war. Interestingly, the poignant report that came out of that work was never published by the Greek government. Later that year, he was sworn in as a minister without portfolio in the cabinet of the short-lived National Unity government of Themistocles Sophoulis. However, he resigned within a couple of months, apparently recognizing his inability to positively impact Greece during these partisan times. An additional disappointment was the rejection of his candidacy for membership at the Academy of Athens, even though he was already the president of the Union of Greek Writers, Ένωση Ελλήνων Λογοτεχνών, likely due to his being perceived as a communist sympathizer, and despite his well-documented disillusionment with the practices of the Stalin regime in the Soviet Union. After these debacles, and with the civil war raging in Greece in 1946, Kazantzakis left on a trip to England, invited by the British Council. However, Cold War sensitivities followed him there. During an interview in which he challenged the officially accepted figure of the size of the communist sympathizers in Greece, 9.3% versus 30%, he was deemed undesirable by the Foreign Office and had to decamp to France. In France, the Greek embassy declined to renew his Greek passport, essentially forbidding him from re-entering his country. Thus, Kazantzakis never returned to Greece, simply settling with Eleni, his Lenotska, in southern France at a modest house in the seaside town of Antibes, the ancient Antipolis near Nice. His home there, the cocoon, Kukuli, became the basis for the last 11 years of his life. And creative cocoon it proved to be. The years in Antibes were very fruitful for his relaxed novel writing. Besides Alexis Zorbas, six novels saw the light of day during that time, all of them important works that became major milestones of Greek and world literature. In 1948 came Christ the Crucified, the story of a Greek village in Asia Minor where a reenactment of the Passion of Christ is being planned. The arrival of a group of refugees perturbs the village's life and compels the young Manolios, whom we saw a little bit earlier, chosen for the role of Christ in the reenactment, to grasp the real meaning of the Christian religion and trying to apply it, to come into conflict with the village's priests and elders and to encounter a violent death inside the church. The book became a major success around the world and it inspired various memorable adaptations, of which we will mention three. The first one, shortly before the author's death in 1957, was as a major French movie entitled Celui qui doit mourir, He Who Must Die, by another 50s exile from his homeland, American director Jules Dassin, and including Dassin's wife, the famous Greek star Melina Mercouri, in a starring role. The second one, shortly thereafter, was as Greek Passion, an opera in four acts by Czech composer Bohuslav Martinů, one of the prolific and reclusive composer's most important works. And the third one was as a major TV series by Hellenic Public Broadcasting in 1975-76, the organization's first major ambitious undertaking, and a major success, as many in the audience may recall. And talking about recollection, comes the time of the quiz. Here's a quiz for our Kazantzakis aficionados in the audience. Which iconic Greek actor played the exact same role in the French movie and Greek TV adaptations of Christ the Crucified? Answer will be given at the reception after this presentation. After Christ the Crucified, Kazantzakis published Kapitan Michalis, the semi-biographical adaptation of the life of his father, set in the Cretan Revolution of 1889 at the Heraklion of the author's childhood. This is an important book, best described as heroic pessimism, which is presented through a series of contrasting pairs, Cretans, Turks, man, woman, intellectual, warrior, love, war, obedience, revolution. The book, often translated as Freedom or Death, was adapted into a memorable theatrical play in 1966, starring Manos Katrakis, with music by none other than the other sacred giant of modern Greek music, Manos Katsidakis. Here's a musical expert. The song, Pou Inai O Theos, Where is the God? Sung by then 19-year-old Giorgos Romanos.
Απλώθηκε το φως στο ψηλό ύψος. Οι άντρες απροσκύνητοι κάνουν τα φιάσελα χωρίς ψωμί, χωρίς φυσέκια. Πού είναι ο Θεός την Κρήτη μας να δει, να δει πονέσει.
Established a new kind of religious storytelling, one in which the evangelical narration is presented from Jesus' own perspective or is reinterpreted by using elements from the Gnostic Gospels and the mythological traditions of the Eastern Mediterranean. In the novel, Jesus is presented as a simple carpenter, selected by God for the mission of human salvation. In the beginning, he refuses insistently, but eventually obeys the divine will. During the crucifixion, he experiences in a vision how his life would have been had God not allowed him to be sacrificed. 3 decades after the author's passing, the 1988 blockbuster movie by Martin Scorsese, with young Willem Dafoe as Jesus and music by Peter Gabriel, captured brilliantly the book's spirit, as shown in this brief mashup of scenes from the movie.
God loves me. I know he loves me. I want him to stop. I can't take the pain, the voices and the pain. I want him to hate me. I fight him and make crosses so he'll hate me. I want him to find somebody else. I want to crucify every one of his messiahs.
Do I have to die? Is there any other way? You're offering me a cup of little winter, God's in it. Please, take it away. Please, stop. Father, give me your hand.
I want to bring salvation. Father, take me back. Make a feast. Welcome me home. I want to be your son. I want to pay the price. I want to be crucified and rise again. I want to be the Messiah.
In that sense, the film, which caused an international furor at the time due to perceptions of blasphemy, also captured Jesus' humanity and self-doubt, as exemplified by this scene.
You think it's a blessing to know what God wants? I'll tell you what he wants. He wants to push me over. Can't you see what's inside of me? My sins.
We all sin.
Not my sins. I'm alive. A hypocrite. I'm afraid of everything. I don't ever tell the truth. I don't have the courage. When I see a woman, I blush and look away. I want her, but I don't take her for God. And that makes me proud. And then my pride runs immaculate. I don't steal, I don't fight, I don't kill. Not because I don't want to, but because I'm afraid. I want to rebel against you, against everything, against God, but I'm afraid. You want to know who my mother and father are? You want to know who my God is? Fear. You look inside me and that's all you'll find.
But the more devils that we have inside of us, the more of a chance we have to repent.
Lucifer is inside me. He says to me, you're not the son of King David. You're not a man, you're the son of man. And more, the son of God. And more than that, God. Do you want to ask me anything else?
Re-examination of the historically enigmatic figure at the basis of the Christian religion, despite, or perhaps because of, incisive emphasis on the concept of universal love, proved too much for church authorities to bear when the book was published in 1954. Given Kazantzakis's clear espousing of philosophical ideas that would be perceived as threats to church practices, doctrine, and power, since his earlier days with Salvatore's Day, as well as the two previous novels, Christ Re-Crucified and Capitan Michalis, publication of The Last Temptation was, in many respects, the last straw. The Vatican acted first by adding The Last Temptation onto the Catholic Church's Index of Prohibited Books, which was still in force at the time. It was only abolished in 1966. Upon receiving the news, our author sent a telegram to the Vatican simply quoting Tertullian, the 3rd century North African father of Latin theology, in his defense. Ad tuum domine tribunal appello. Make me appeal, my appeal at your court, O Lord. The Church of Greece, in its turn, undertook a series of formal reviews of Kazantzakis' books, amid calls from within church circles for his excommunication. These widely publicized efforts were driven by various bishops within the see of the Church of Greece in mainland Greece, but not by the Church of Crete, which was and is under the direct jurisdiction of the Ecumenical Patriarch of Constantinople. In the end, Kazantzakis was not excommunicated from the Orthodox Church, since the Ecumenical Patriarch since 1949, the energetic and popular Athinagoras, was against such a drastic step. Nevertheless, many church figures in Greece maintained their disapproval of him. To them, Kazantzakis gave the following memorable reply. Μου δώσατε μια κατάρα, Άγιοι Πατέρες. Σας δίνω μια ευχή. Σας εύχομαι Να είναι η συνείδησή σας τόσο καθαρή όσο η δική μου και να είστε τόσο ηθικοί και θρήσκοι όσο είμαι εγώ. At that time, Kazantzakis developed his last great friendship. This one was reserved for yet another kindred spirit, the French-German doctor, theologian, organist, humanitarian, and Nobel Peace Prize winner, Albert Schweitzer, 1875 to 1965, who was by his bedside when our author passed away at the hospital in Freiburg, Germany, on October 26, 1957. The three last years of Kazantzakis' life saw the creation of his last three major novels, Οφτωχούλης του Θεού, God's Little Poor Man, a novel-style rendering of the life of St. Francis of Assisi, dedicated to Albert Schweitzer, Αναφορά στον Greco, Report to Greco, a spiritual autobiography of our author's passionate and tumultuous early years, rendered in the form of a homage to the other Cretan giant, the uniquely masterful Renaissance painter who became a citizen of Toledo, Spain, Dominikos Theotokopoulos, and Αδελφοφάδες, The Fratricides, a poignant story set in the dark years of the Greek Civil War of the late 40s at the fictional village in northern Greece. Here are a few quotes from the most philosophical of these three books, Report to Greco.
Άστρα, πουλιά, σπόροι μες στο χώμα, όλα υπακούν. Και μόνο ο άνθρωπος σηκώνει κεφάλι και θέλει να παραβεί τον νόμο και να μετατρέψει την υπακοή σε ελευθερία. Γι' αυτό και από όλα τα πλάσματα του Θεού, αυτός μονάχα μπορεί και αμαρτένει. Τι θα πει αμαρτένει, χαρνάει την αρμονία. Έχουν να πούν πως ο άνθρωπος είναι το ζώο που συλλογαίνει το θάνατο. Όχι, σου λέω εγώ. Άνθρωπος είναι το ζώο που συλλογαίνει την αθανασία. Δεν το φοβάμαι το Θεό. Αυτός καταλαβαίνει και συγχωρνάει. Τους ανθρώπους φοβάμαι. Αυτοί δεν καταλαβαίνουν και δεν συγχωρνούν. Ο χριστιανισμός, στιγματίζοντας ως αμαρτία την ένωση αντρός και γυναικός, τη μόλευσε. Και ενώ προστίτα ήταν άγια πράξη, χαρούμενη υποταγή στο θέλημα του Θεού, κατάντησε στην περίτρομη ψυχή του χριστιανού αμαρτία. Ένα μήλο κόκκινο ήταν πριν από τον Χριστό ο έρωτας. Ήρθε ο Χριστός και ένα σκουλίκι μπήκε μέσα στο μήλο και το τρώει. Ένα θεριό που δεν ξέρει πως είναι θεριό, είναι η νιώτη.
It would be amiss to not mention that in the 50s, Kazantzakis gave some radio and television interviews. A few survive today, allowing us to hear his voice. Here's a short excerpt with some words related to iconic Irish playwright George Bernard Shaw, recorded for the Hellenic service of the BBC in 1953.
Αν ο κόσμος δεν ήταν καμωμένος από τον Ιεχωβά, αλλά από τον Όμηρο, ο Μπέρναρντ Σόου θα ήταν ένας κοκκινογέννης θεός του Ολύμπου και θα είχε αχώριστο σύντροφο κοντά του τον Φερσίτη να τον γερνά. Νυφάλιος αιώνια ο ένας, ολομέθιστος αιώνια ο άλλος, θα κοίταζαν από ψηλά τον κόσμο και θα γελούσαν ο ένας γιατί ο κόσμος είναι τόσο όμορφος, ο άλλος γιατί ο κόσμος είναι τόσο άσχημος και οι δυο μαζί γιατί ξέρουν το μεγάλο μυστικό. Πως όλος αυτός ο περίφημος τροϊκός πόλεμος έγινε όχι για την Ελένη παρά για τον ίστο της Ελένης. Η αληθινή Ελένη είχε καταφύγει κυνηγημένη και αμόλευτη στο κεφάλι του Μπέρναρντ Σόου σαν μια μεγάλη ιδέα.
During his 11 productive years of de facto exile in Antibes, Kazantzakis kept being nominated almost every year for the Nobel Prize in Literature, oftentimes getting very close to actually winning the prize. In the end, he never won, however, thus joining upon his passing 60 years ago the list of other famous snubbed writers like Leo Tolstoy, Marcel Proust, James Joyce, and Virginia Woolf. In 1957, the winner of the prize was the French existential writer Albert Camus, a kindred spirit. Kazantzakis warmly telegraphed his congratulations to the 30 years younger Camus from his deathbed at the hospital in Freiburg, Germany. Camus later returned the gesture, stating in a letter to his widow, Eleni, that I was regretfully receiving a distinction that Kazantzakis deserved 100 times more. This statement by Camus was not pleasantry. Camus was greatly influenced by Kazantzakis' philosophy. In his signature essay, The Myth of Sisyphus, 1939, Camus had attempted to find a meaning to life when one accepted the renunciation of the existence of God and eternal values. In his interpretation of the myth, in which Sisyphus is condemned to eternally roll a rock up a hill that no sooner reaches the top, rolls down to the other side, Camus asserts that the hero provides a way to proceed beyond the paralysis of nihilism. As Sisyphus is conscious of the futility and hence absurdity of his action, he's able to transcend the despair that might easily have followed. For Sisyphus, the value in life is to be found not in its inherent meaning, but in one's attitude towards it. This attitude is one of revolt, the refusal to be paralyzed by the consciousness of the absurdity of our existence. Camus concludes his interpretation of the myth as follows. The struggle itself towards the heights is enough to fill a man's heart. We must imagine Sisyphus happy. In a similar way, Kazantzakis sees this approach to Sisyphus as a way beyond nihilism and despair. In a 1947 letter he wrote to his friend, the Swedish politician and translation of his works, Birger Knös, "What is the right path?" an Indian proverb asks. "The path of God." And what is the path of God? The uphill path. Humanity will once again take the uphill path, like Sisyphus. Kazantzakis proceeds to refer to himself as a tragic optimist, which, according to his wife, Eleni, describes someone who has confidence in man, who looks straight at the demon of destruction, hates it, but is not afraid of it, because he knows that all destruction is but the preparatory stage to a new creation. This emphasis on destruction as a preparatory stage to a new creation is based on Kazantzakis' belief in his present epoch as a transitional age, an age that must seek to create a new channel for the spirit and move from a middle age to a renaissance. This desire for a new channel for the spirit is a result of the dissatisfaction Kazantzakis felt with the overtly materialistic approach of communism. In order for humanity to continue ascending the uphill path and hence achieve freedom from the obstruction of materiality, Kazantzakis asserts that the creative artist must flourish. This is an idea largely influenced by Bergson's notion of the vital impulse in life, l'élan vital, which seeks to conglomerate with matter in order to overcome it. Using his own idiosyncratic language and philosophy, Kazantzakis claims that in working with matter, the artist creates the channel for the spirit that is required for the uphill path. In Kazantzakian terminology, humanity must become the saviors of God. Kazantzakis' passing at the age of 74 on October 26, 1957, made him one more victim of the 1957 Asian flu pandemic, the second of the three major flu outbreaks of the 20th century. He contracted the flu on an official trip to China, ultimately due to a weak immune system resulting from leukemia, a disease he had lived with for many years and which he had kept at bay with the help of the German doctor at whose hospital, rushed in a hurry, he eventually passed away. His funeral became a major publicized affair, since the Greek Orthodox Church authorities did not want him administered the burial rites at the cemetery. After a brief stopover of the Onassis-funded special flight with Kazantzakis' body in Athens, the funeral of our author was a massively attended memorable event at the Heraklion Cathedral on Crete with the presence of Crete's archbishop. However, only one lowly young priest broke ranks with church authorities and actually administered the last rites at Kazantzakis' burial site atop a most beautiful and serene spot, the Martinenko rampart of Heraklion. A lot of vitriol ensued, with one of the more extreme young church leaders at the time, the outspoken Bishop Augustinos of Florina in northern Greece, then an Archimandrite, proclaiming, in an echo of the hatred that the great spirits of humanity from Socrates to Jesus and beyond inspire, almost as a manifestation of the Newtonian law of action and reaction.
Σήμερα ήταν μια σκοτεινή μέρα του ελληνικού έθνους. Ο γλυκέτατος Χριστός ξανασταυρώθηκε από τους εχθρούς αντιπροσώπους της λογοτεχνίας και του κράτους. Ρεζίλια των σκυλιών γίνανε. Η συντέλεια των αιώνων έφτασε. Η πένα του βρωμερού αντίχριστου ξέσχισε το στήθος του Κυρίου. Βόθρος ρέει από τους ακάθαρτους ποταμούς στις σελίδες του ανήθικου. Σήμερα η Ελλάς σκυδεύει με δημόσια δαπάνη ποιον, τον υβριστή της Εκκλησίας μας. Και ο Υπουργός Παιδείας και ο Πρίτανης Πανεπιστημίου Θεσσαλονίκης, κρατώντας με ασέβεια τα διαστραμμένα βιβλία του βλάσφημου αντί του Ευαγγελίου, πένεψαν τον εσχρό νεκρό. Φρίκι, φρίκι, ούτε ο υπόνομος των Αθηνών δεν θα ανέβηδε τέτοια δυσοδεία. Έφτασε η Δευτέρα Παρουσία. Θλίψη, θλίψη. Και το θλιβερότερο, ο Μητροπολίτης Ευγένιος, παρόλο που ειδοποιήθηκε αυστηρά από την ιεραρχία, άφησε το βλάστημο να μπει μέσα σε ελληνική χριστιανική εκκλησία και παραστεί στην κηδεία του. Έβγε άγριε της Κρήτης, Μητροπολίτη Ευγένιε. Η εκκλησία της Κρήτης έδωσε εξετάσεις σήμερα και μηδενίστηκε στη συνείδηση Ορθοδοξίας. Ντροπή σας, χειδεολόγοι της πίστης μας. Να πάτε στις χαύρες, να πάτε σε τζαμιά, αλλά να μην πατήσετε τα πόδια σας σε ιερό ναό της Εκκλησίας μας, πριτάνης των πανεπιστημίων, λογοτέχνες και πολιτικοί. Αν ζούσαν σήμερα οι τρεις ιεράρχες, θα σας είχαν αφορέσει όλους σας.
So, why should we remember Kazantzakis 60 years after his passing? As each one of us ponders his life and his writings, the answer becomes invariably quite personal. Some will deify him as the voice that put modern Greek prose on the map, or as the originator master storyteller of new universal mythical personas like Zorba. Others will focus on the incisiveness of his philosophical musings and aphorisms, or even on the memorable anecdotes from his travel books. Yet others will dismiss him as a man of his times, an ambitious yet mediocre writer that is slowly being forgotten. For me, Kazantzakis resonates, and always will, as a kindred spirit, as the ever-present, bold, and honest maverick who dared close the gap, both with his life and with his works, between Ulysses and my time, thus allowing me to see with his creations and his humanness that the world is one's oyster. As a very good Greek friend of mine always likes to say when we part, do not despair, my friend. Always aim for the stars and keep your feet on the ground. Thank you for being with us tonight.